first is that you'll notice today's sermon title is Distracted by Many Things. Well, it appears that while I was putting the bulletins together on Friday, I was distracted by many things, and I wound up with two inside pieces. And so there might be a couple of you out there who have bulletins that are just page 2 and page 7. I will trade you for a page 4 and page 5. So if you find that your bulletin is not put together properly, I've got your missing pieces here. As we begin, let me also announce that with our Facebook Live video feed, we've recognized that we are dealing with some audio issues where the audio will kind of silence and then regain strength. Not entirely sure what's causing that, so you'll notice a little bit of a different video setup this morning, and part of that is troubleshooting, trying to find a better product, if you will, for our viewing experience. So if you are watching this on Facebook Live, we are aware that there might be some audio issues that you experienced during that, and we're going to take steps to rectify that situation. In addition to that announcement, I do have an additional prayer concern to add to your list, and that is the name of David Walbert. David is a brother-in-law of David Payne, who was in a motorcycle accident, hit by a drunk driver in the University of Louisville Hospital with a broken leg. Is that correct? And so please add David Walbert to your prayer list today. With that being said, we do have a meeting this coming Wednesday evening, Thanksgiving planning meeting for those who are interested in helping this happen again this year. The time of the meeting is 5:30, and we will be in the fellowship hall to continue taking steps to making sure this year's meal happens in a way that's effective in serving the needs of our community. Those are the announcements that I have to share as we begin today, other than the obvious, our organist is not with us this morning. So thank you to Ann for carrying the weight of our musical accompaniment in this morning's worship. But with that being stated and that being said, any other announcements to share? Hearing none, may we join in the purpose for which we are gathered from our various homes and our various lives. May we unite our hearts and voices as we are present in the midst of and in the presence of a living God. May we know that to be true, and may we sense God's leading by His Spirit in our worship, our music, our songs, and our prayers. Thank you. tendency that is not towards the good side of things. He says that all of us are sinners and fall short of the glory of God. In fact, we're reminded in 1 John that if we claim to be without sin, we deceive ourselves and the truth is not in us. Yet that scripture goes on to assure us with more comforting words, saying that those who confess their sins, God will forgive their sins and cleanse their righteousness. And so it is with comfort that we humbly approach God in our prayer and confession. May we do so today, lifting our voices together, again humbly praying before God. Forgive us, loving God, for hurrying past you in our daily lives. We crowd our lives with so many frenetic activities. Many of them worthwhile, and yet we forget the one painful thing. We work hard to make ends meet, but forget the one thing needful. We spend time with our loved ones, but forget the one thing needful. We give to worthwhile causes, but forget the one thing needful. O Lord, may we never forget your presence again. Forgive us for our self-preoccupation, neglecting our lives with you. Move us to your heart all over again, and show us the joy, meaning, and purpose that come from living our lives in you. Through Christ, our strong Savior, we pray. Amen. The great gospel proclamation is that God so loved the world that he gave his only Son, that whoever believes in him should not perish but have eternal life. That proclamation continues with an additional subsequent verse that says that God did not send his Son into the world to judge the world, but that the world might be saved through him. And so with confidence in this good news, may we again acknowledge that in Jesus Christ our sins are forgiven. Thanks be to God.
Glory be to the Father.
Prayer. I want you to think about when you could stop and listen to God this week. Let's bow our heads and pray. Dear Lord, thank you for giving us hands to work and ears to listen. Help us to know when to work and when to listen. It's in your name we pray. Amen.
Turning to the 10th chapter of Luke for our second reading today, our focus is on the 13th through 42nd verses. Read this way. Now as they went on their way, this is Jesus and his disciples, as they went on their way, he entered a certain village where a woman named Martha welcomed him into her home. She had a sister named Mary who sat at the Lord's feet and listened to what he was saying. But Martha was distracted by her many tasks. So she came to him and asked, "Lord, do you not care that my sister has left me to do all the work for myself? Tell her to help me." But the Lord answered her, "Martha, Martha, you are worried and distracted by many things. There is need of only one thing. Mary has chosen the better part, which will not be taken away from her." Friends, this is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
And now, at this time, may the words of my mouth and the meditation of all of our hearts be acceptable in your sight, O Lord, for you are our rock and our redeemer. I'd like to begin by talking about something that happens. It could be called a new game in town, although it's been a new game in town for 29 consecutive years. And it's a game that attracts contestants, contestants in the past have come from as far away as Pakistan and Denmark, Argentina and Zimbabwe. And these people have convened on the metropolis of New York Mills, Minnesota, and participated in an event at their cultural center. Again, they're not coming to New York Mills to play Monopoly. Not coming to arm wrestle. They're not coming to play bridge or chess. That's not what they're there for. They're there for an event called the Great American Think-Off. We've talked about this before, but I mention it again because I think it's apropos to this particular story in Scripture. And it's this Great American Think-Off, which is held in June of every year. Again, in the booming metropolis of New York Mills, Minnesota, population 972. In the heart of Otter Tail County, nonetheless. And each year, into Otter Tail County, four finalists are chosen from hundreds of contestants from across the country and sometimes across the globe. All are vying for a right to be called or to be given the title America's Greatest Thinker. Questions are released by the committee in January of each year. And then there are 4 months in which contestants can deliberate on their answer and submit their response in essay form by mid-April. Again, this is not the sort of thing for highfalutin college professors, not anything that is necessary or does not require an ivory tower dweller to participate. This, if you want to call it an intellectual battle royale, calls upon everyday folks. Everyday folks are called upon to wrestle with the heavyweight questions of life and, if possible, to come to a convincing conclusion for others. Armchair philosophers, I guess we could call them. And each one answers the same big question. Again, the questions come out in January. And in 750 words or less, they write an essay and then mail it into Minnesota, taking into account their own personal experiences in their responses. Then the committee has work to do to judge the four most thoughtful of these contestants and selects them to come together to debate on national television, nonetheless. And in past years, the Today Show has covered it. C-SPAN, the New York Times, Smithsonian Magazine, pardon me, getting tongue-tied a little bit and ahead of myself. Smithsonian Magazine and Christian Science Monitor have all at one time or another covered this annual debate, this notorious annual debate. So what kind of questions qualify to be the big question? Well, one year it was, is the nature of humankind inherently good or inherently evil? Yes, good question. I think we will all agree. And other questions have included money or morality. Which does society value more? Does God exist? Which is more dangerous, science or religion? Ooh, good question there. Is honesty the best policy? And this year, the 29th annual contest. Which should be more important, the question asks, personal choice or social responsibility? Well, if you want to find how contestants answer, those are available online. You just have to Google the Great American Think Off and you can find the results of what happened this past June. But I'm not bringing this up for talking about who won this year's contest. Obviously, we're using it to dovetail into something else. Interestingly enough, in 1993, one final detail about this Great American Think Off, the question was, does life have meaning? You know who won that, well, by, not by name, but by what profession do you think the person who answered that question most appropriately, according to the committee? In 1993, the question was, does life have meaning? And the winner of the response to that question was an uneducated fisherman. I think there's no missing the uniqueness of that. It's pretty timely, biblically fitting, if you will, for a fisherman to have the answer or the best answer to that question. In fact, the Bible does pose many great questions. Sometimes they're simple questions, or at least understood in a more simple format. And the Bible even goes on to answer those questions. And often they're direct questions. What must we do to inherit eternal life would be one such direct question. And who is my neighbor? Another direct question. Other times, though, the questions are implied, like the question raised by the text we read today about Mary and Martha. You and I, in reading this pericope, are challenged by a remark that Jesus, a carpenter from Nazareth of Galilee, made to his friend Martha during a visit to her home. We read just a moment ago that during Jesus' visit, Martha was working hard. She was at work in the kitchen while her sister was just conversing with Jesus there in the parlor. And Martha complains to Jesus, asking him to send her into the kitchen to help. Jesus says to Martha that Mary has chosen the better part. So our think-off question today is it better to be Mary or a Martha? And of course, it's the simple form of that question. You see, if being a Martha is understood as being a type of active Christian, the Christian at work in the world, and if Mary is seen as a type of passive Christian, withdrawn from the world in a quest for solitude and prayer and contemplation. The question then can move beyond the Mary Martha conversation to a discussion about the relative merits of active service over and against quiet and pietistic devotion. Martha Christians sweat and slave in the kitchen of the world, and the Mary Christians prefer to study, pray, reflect, and maybe make daily journal entries and things like that. But Jesus's answer, or Jesus's response, seems to indicate that Mary's the one that's got it right and Martha's the one that's got it wrong. Wrong? In a certain sense, that is. And his words are a strong reminder that sometimes we get distracted by many things. We too find ourselves being busy, instead of just being in the presence of God. We tend to get preoccupied with serving God and forget to take time out to know God better. And perhaps, in a sense, it's a false argument or a false dilemma. It's quite possible that Mary, we don't know the backstory, maybe Mary did her part in the kitchen and helped her sister with the preparation prior to Jesus' arrival. Maybe Martha's the procrastinator. Maybe she'd already cleaned the sitting room and swept off the porch, kneaded the bread and stoked the fire. Whatever the case may be, when the guest arrived, the work, she knew, must come to an end. And she chose, when the guest arrived, in that time and in that place, to sit at the feet of Jesus and engage in a conversation. It's interesting to note that we don't know the content or the details of that conversation, but they were both there in that time, in that space together, and it was meaningful. Martha, on the other hand, couldn't let it go. No, for Martha, nothing was quite right. This presentation had to be just so. We've got a special guest here. And so when Mary doesn't share this obsessive compulsive behavior that Martha is displaying, by the way, I've heard Martha referred to as the patron saint of multitasking. Can we identify with that? But anyway, Martha in this instance throws a bit of what we would call a fit or a tantrum, right? We're all familiar with this kind of tantrum or fit. It's a condition that develops when we feel tired, overworked, underpaid, underappreciated, misunderstood. We're stretched to our limits and nobody else is recognizing. In other words, this dilemma is, in a sense, a question of balance. And in our story, Mary had it. Martha did not. Do we? Where do we stand on the balance scale? Unfortunately, Martha, in her choices, had moved at such a dizzying pace that her focus shifted from her guest to herself and the tasks that were at hand. And we can kind of sympathize with Martha because she's just trying to be hospitable, right, in a certain sense. And hospitality is, after all, a spiritual gift. But evidently, Martha had broke the cardinal rule of hospitality by shoving her guest to the side and becoming the center of attention herself. Who's she doing all this for anyhow? She even fussed at Jesus a little too, didn't she? As if he was falling short on doing his part. Why hadn't he demanded that Mary get off her knees and come into the kitchen to help her sister? Jesus says that Mary is the one who is the model we should emulate. Martha, though, is the reality we experience, isn't she? There's no question for you and for me that we live in a world that is a Martha world. In fact, sometimes the church is guilty of encouraging. Church tells us to get out there, beat the pavement, go spread the good news, go work for justice, go be involved in mission. And we hear and respond to this challenge to serve by saying that it is responding to our calling. And it's not altogether that it's not. But when various opportunities come along and committees or work groups or other individuals in the church remind us of opportunities to volunteer for this and for that, to attend this week's event, to donate time in the Thanksgiving dinner, for instance, to help fill shoeboxes for Christmas gifts for those less fortunate. When these are the encouragements, are we just busy being busy, or is this an extension of a deeper rooted faith that is rooted and deepened at the feet of Jesus? Are we encouraged to just be Martha's, or are we encouraged to be Mary's first? You see, what is at issue is not whether it's possible to be a Mary in a Martha world. The answer to that is yes, it is indeed possible. But the question becomes how? And for starters, on the how answer to that question, we might recognize that it's important to stop talking for a little bit and listen. We are reminded from time to time in life we have two ears and one mouth. Yet we live in a world that kind of facilitates using the mouth more than the ears. And for the active Christian, in each of us, we are prompted, we are encouraged, and we are empowered even to speak up, to express ourselves and our faith, and to make our demands. But if we consider it so much our story, we're missing the point. If we consider the point of this story, we find in terms of priorities that Jesus calls us to stop talking, stop telling Jesus what to do. Stop. Sit quietly and listen to what Jesus is saying to us first and foremost. And maybe then the words we speak, maybe then the actions that we take in the world would be wiser if we listened first and foremost to what Jesus is trying to say to us. Jesus is saying, focus on something beside yourself. Martha, Martha, you frenzied little worker bee. You're worried and distracted by many things. Focus on something beyond yourself. Sometimes even when we are frantically trying to take care of everybody, aren't we really trying to prove how terribly valuable we are to have around? Then who is the service really to? I think that becomes the crux of the matter, or the crux of the question that we are asking. For you and for me, we need to start with an understanding that it is better to be being initially than it is to be doing initially. The doing will follow. But a person who has learned how to be a human being will certainly have no trouble working out how to be a human doing. So our answer to our think-off question this year, is it better to be a Mary or a Martha? Well, one would think we'd have to side with the world's greatest thinker that we know when he said, it's Mary. It's Mary. And that answer helps us recognize that the essence of the Christian life is that the outward journey is rooted in and sustained by the inward journey to sit at the feet of Christ, attending to Christ's presence, Christ who is our Lord, Christ who is our Redeemer, Christ who is himself our model for servanthood in the world, sitting at Christ's presence, at Christ's feet, and in his presence. That matters to us. Should matter the most. And so let us always remember to take time to be the people of God first and foremost, so that in our doing we may be formed into the people that he needs us to be to accomplish the work of the kingdom in the world around us, today and always. Amen and amen. Take my life and let it be as the hymn with which our worship continues. May we stand.
Take my life and let it be gone.
Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Ghost, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sitteth on the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Ghost, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Thank you, and please be seated. At this time, may we turn to God for our corporate prayers. And as we begin this time, I invite you to insert before our listing of our shared concerns, to spend a little time talking to God about your concerns, your life, your joys, your celebrations, the things that burden you, as well as the things that encourage you. May we, in our own hearts, spend a moment in silence as we begin our prayer time together today. In your mercy, Lord, hear our prayer. Again, it is with joy that we have the opportunity to bow before you and acknowledge you, the great God, our Creator, our Sustainer, our Redeemer. And in your presence, may we find joy as we lift up our voices in worship. As we spend time in your presence, may we be enriched. May we be strengthened in our knowledge of the priorities that you have, of the joy you desire for us, of the love you lavish upon us, and of your presence with us always, even to the end of the age. Lord, we thank you for your presence in our lives, and we admit that all too often we busy ourselves not acknowledging your presence, but going about doing things without our true aim being your purpose in our lives and our world. So help us. Help us to reconnect often and on our times, or in our times of regularly reconnecting, to be re-energized and refocused for the callings you have for each of us. Lord, again, we pray for our world. We pray for our state and its leaders. We pray for local leaders as well. And we pray for individuals connected to our church home as we lift up and name before you Mary, Morris, Ray and Bethany, Mark and Terry, Janice and Carolyn, Jennifer, Faye, and Tuddy, Tandy, Jerry, Sue, and Clara, Frank, and Sam, Kevin, and Pat. Hear us as we pray for Sylvia, and Pam, and Wendell, Nolan, and John, Raina, Milton, Lacey, and Debbie, Mary, and Joanne, as we pray for the family of Edward and the family of Mary. We pray for David, and as we continue to pray for the communities of Highland Park, Uvalde, and Buffalo, as we continue to pray for Ukraine, as we continue to pray for our own church and our home presbytery here in Mid-Kentucky, as we lift up to you prayers for protection for those serving in our troops at home and abroad, and as we lift up the Higby family. Again, to these named requests, we add these to our unspoken requests with which we began our prayer time today. Again, knowing that you are a God who hears and acknowledges and answers our prayers, may we be faithful to listen to the ways that you are responding to our needs and our desires. Help us to understand the ways that you are shaping us, turn this portion, we accompany it with a prayer that says, thank you, as well as use these gifts, we pray, as your will directs, that further the ministry and mission of this, your church, in accomplishing your will on earth as it is in heaven. We ask this in your holy name, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen and amen. Friends, be thou my vision is our concluding hymn this morning. May we remain standing as we wrap our worship up. Today, I want to say a word or two in Martha's defense. Kind of all seems unfair to Martha, doesn't it? Well, I want to use the words of the author, the artist of the picture you find on page 2 in your bulletins. It's a black and white. Mary and Martha is the name of the work, and Kara Hochalter is the artist. And one of her comments about her work of art is this, and it is, I think, appropriate for giving Martha a little bit of a fair shake. She said, a friend of mine who loves to cook complained that Martha gets a bad rap in this story when she should be honored for making the meal. So I focused in my art on Martha. I wanted to capture her exasperation of feeling torn between her obligation to provide a meal and wanting to hear what stories Jesus was telling her sister. Many of us who prepare meals can relate to this situation. We might also relate to Martha when she gets a little perturbed. Why isn't her sister helping her? Perhaps Martha is jealous and a little childishly angry as she asks Jesus to make Mary help. The stories around Jesus touch us on very human levels, on very human feelings that we can see ourselves in today. Perhaps there is a way to meet both our contemplative needs and our desire for doing at the same time. The artist concludes her remarks by saying, I am reminded of the 17th century lay monk Brother Lawrence, who spent years learning how to practice the presence of God at the same time that he was doing ordinary chores such as preparing meals for the monastery. What a delightful challenge for us. Yes, indeed, what a delightful challenge for us to learn how to practice the presence of God at the same time as doing the ordinary tasks of life. May we tip our hat to Martha. May we follow Mary, putting priorities in line and doing the first thing first, being in the presence of the one whose presence we need in our lives. May we, first and foremost, find ourselves at the feet of Jesus. And being at the feet of Jesus, may we be rooted and grounded to then go and do the work of
of the kingdom. Today and always, may we know the love of God in our lives. Today and always, may we know the redemption and the forgiveness offered through Christ, his Son. Today and always, may we know the power and presence of God's Holy Spirit, which is alive and at work in our lives. May we open our hearts to give it room to do that work. Go today and always knowing the peace of God, which passes all understanding. Amen and amen.